on page 1642 in your new Bible. Hear now these words. But on the first day of the week at early dawn, they came to the tomb and taking the spices they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they went in, they did not find the body. While they were perplexed about this, suddenly two men in dazzling clothes stood beside them. The women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen. Remember what he told you while he was still in Galilee, that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified, and on the third day rise up." Then they remembered his words, and returning from the tomb, they told all of this to the 11 and all the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, and Mary, the mother of James, and the other women who told this to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. But Peter got up and ran to the tomb. Stooping and looking in, he saw the linen cloths by themselves. Then he went home, amazed at what had happened. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I've never been to Death Valley in California, but I know it is described as the hottest, driest, and lowest place in North America. A below sea level basin with a steady drought and record of summer heat make Death Valley a land of extremes, with the temperature regularly reaching about 120 degrees in the shade, and only cools down to about 85 or 90 at night. Surrounding Death Valley are towering peaks frosted with winter snow. But in the midst of the basin, surprisingly, there is life. Lush oases harbor tiny fish and become a refuge for wildlife. Despite its morbid name, Death Valley supports a great diversity of life. Most of the pictures I have seen of Death Valley show a seemingly endless expanse of flat, dry, no end, parched, brittle, and cracked earth. It looks beautiful and looks like it would be entirely uninhabitable. But this year, the pictures are different. Death Valley is blooming. It is full of life, even more so than normal. Full of bright, colorful wildflowers. Where what used to be nothing but dirt and dust, millions of flowers have painted the landscape yellow. Ever since January, these flowers have been in bloom due to the perfect combination of a few elements. More rainfall than normal, solar warmth, and reduced winds. This burst of life in the midst of Death Valley is being called a super bloom, which apparently happens about every 10 years. It's as if those seeds have been lying in wait, waiting for the perfect conditions to break through dry ground, bursting forth life in the midst of Death Valley. Barbara Kingsolver beautifully described a previous story, saying that the wildflowers looked like seed-packed promises come true. What a perfect description of both the flowers in the desert and of the Easter promise of resurrection and new life. Every year we retell the story of our faith. Every year we journey together through Holy Week. The stories are familiar. The promises are the same. And each year we see God fulfilling God's promise of life even in the midst of death. Each year we are reminded that God dwells wherever new life breaks forth. We are surrounded by death all the time. But Jesus' resurrection is our eternal reminder that death will never have the last word, that love conquers hate and fear, and hope always wins out against despair. With our world so overwhelmed with death and fear and despair, I think we need the resurrection even more this year. We need to hear the good news of resurrection, life conquering death. But even more than that, we need the reminder that resurrection resurrection is the ongoing work of God's people, of us, the faithful, who are engaged in the broken world. And not just an amazing thing that God did at that one time. We need that reminder that resurrection happens all the time. If only we have eyes to see it. Have you noticed it, resurrection? It seems that just this week here in Richmond has erupted in blooms. Beautiful shades of green everywhere, trees with white or yellow or pink blossoms, and flowers bursting through the earth. I love that often nature becomes colorful and full of life right around Easter. It's another reminder of life in the midst of death. Because the date of Easter is determined by the moon, falling on the first Sunday after the first full moon on or after the spring equinox, Easter often coincides with the green of the earth. Christ is risen and the whole world comes to life. Nature beautifully tells the story of resurrection each spring. As we experience the resurrection again today, we welcome this new life. Yet we also know that both life and death reside together in our deepest places. Unbearable loss sits beside deep joy. Hope lives with dread. Success and failure, heartbreak and contentment, health and illness, laughter and melancholy all live together within each of us. The message of Easter, then, is not that life leaves death behind forever. It is that life and death share an uneasy cohabitation, but love is stronger, even than death. God's love helps us to hold on to in our darkest hours and in our brightest ones. The darkness of death is always with us, but the beauty of life pulls us forward into some bright future that we have not yet even begun to envision, where love reigns and overcomes hatred and darkness. When I lived in Nashville, Tennessee, I was introduced to a local musician named Matthew Harrington Jones when he and his band wrote music for a Nashville ballet performance I was attending. I was moved by how perfectly the music and movement worked together. I immediately knew that I needed that music in my life, so that night I bought his album called Land of the Living, which is where I get the title of my sermon from, and have been listening to that album ever since. But listening to it this week, during Holy Week, I'm experiencing it with all new ears. It touches all of the emotions of Holy Week: despair, sadness, grief, and confusion. And after going on a journey through so much darkness, the last song, also called Land of the Living, is a beautiful breath of fresh air, almost like a rebirth. It is hopeful, brave, and it reminds me of the Easter promise. Into the land of the living, black leaves orange into blue, and coming to life, light is breaking through, Matthew sings. You cannot love in moderation, lay your soul on the threshing floor. We made it alive. We are not alone. It's the Easter story, new life breaking through. And it's our own response to the Easter story, too. Our journey of stepping into our own new life with God. Jesus' resurrection changes everything and brings us into the land of the living. We receive the gift of new life, and in a way, it changes everything for us. And so we, too, live a new life. We see the world through new eyes and with a new sense of amazement and awe and wonder. Early on that first Easter morning, as light was breaking through, the women, Mary Magdalene, Joanna, and Mary, the mother of James, came to the tomb in order to prepare Jesus for burial. As I imagine it, they arrived at the tomb just as the sun rises over the earth. It's a beautiful time of first light. The dark sky gradually grows lighter and more colorful. Heartbreakingly beautiful for these women, whose hearts are full of grief and sorrow. Consumed by their sadness, they arrive and are confused by what they see. It's not at all what they expected, but God never does, but finding the stone rolled away and the tomb empty. And in the midst of the beautiful early morning light, two men in dazzling clothing stand before them, and they are frightened. "Why do you look for the living among the dead?" they ask. "What do you mean, that living? Is Jesus alive? Don't you remember those things he told you, that he would be crucified and on the third day rise again?" And so hearing this, they go and run and tell the disciples the good news. In this moment, the women knew, and we know, that the boundless gift of the empty tomb cannot be separated from the words and actions of Jesus. Theologian Nancy Pittman continues, saying, "Resurrection is, after all, not some buoyant ideal unconnected to the real world. It's an invitation to live as Jesus lived, a doorway to a life which meals are shared with enemies, healing is offered to the hopeless, and prophetic challenges are issued to the powerful. It is we ourselves who see the last subversive power of the resurrection in order to live it now." On that first dim Easter morning, when women cowered in the dust and angels picked them back up, pointing them out the door of the tomb and unto the full light of morning, the power of God was no longer unspoken. The silence was broken, and the women rushed back to tell the others what they had seen. No matter that the others didn't believe at first, who could believe, really, given the circumstances? And no matter that Peter had to test the women's story by running to the tomb, seeing himself the linen clothes, wondering all the way back home of what he had seen, the women knew. The women remembered. The women believed. The women responded by breaking their own silence to speak their own truth, which is exactly, after all, what God calls us to do. The women who had been with Jesus from the beginning, who had witnessed Jesus' crucifixion, who had seen the corpse laid into the tomb, are the first ones to tell it all to the rest. Their witness to the resurrection started it all. And we, to this day, continue telling their story to all who will listen. Christ is risen. Hear the good news, that God's story is one of new life and new beginnings. That God's story is one of great love and forgiveness and hope. There's a new musical on Broadway that tells the story of the life of the first Treasury Secretary Alexander Hamilton, told through the language and music of rap and hip-hop, naturally. It's true. I discovered the cast recording a few months ago and have been listening to it non-stop. Hamilton tells a captivating story of a man I learned about in 7th grade history, which of course I quickly forgot. The first time I listened to the whole musical, I was struck by how fascinating this founding father on the $10 bill's life and death were. Really, it is. I couldn't believe it either. The very last song of the musical, though, after Alexander Hamilton has been shot and killed by Aaron Burr in a duel, Hamilton's wife, Eliza, sings a beautiful song about his life and the importance of continuing to tell his story. "Who lives, who dies, who tells your story?" she asks as she promises to make sure people will remember Hamilton. She decides to live out the rest of her long life telling Alexander's story. "Who lives, who dies, who tells your story?" I could ask that same question to each of you this Easter morning. We have been into the tomb and found it empty. We remember all that he taught, all whom he had healed. We know who Jesus is. So who will tell his story? Well, we will, of course. Just like the women who ran from the tomb to tell the others, we go from this place with a story to tell. A story of life conquering death. A story of a love so great we can hardly explain it. A story of hope prevailing in the midst of despair. It's a wonderful story, one that I love to tell. But more importantly, it's one that I need to hear told again and again and again. friends. What else can we do but go from here proclaiming the greatest story of all, that death is not the end?